Welcome. In this class, we'll start with the physical features of India. Now, we have already talked about those in brief in the class 7. Now, moving forward, let's first understand what is the basis for different physical features in any area. Now, I can say there can be a region where there are plains, there are plateaus, there are mountains. Why does such variation occur? It is attributed mainly to the different rock types that occur. So, we already know there are three basic types of rocks. The igneous rocks, sedimentary rocks, and metamorphic rocks. Now, metamorphic rocks are those which are formed by high pressure. When high pressure and temperature is exerted either onto igneous or sedimentary, you have metamorphic rock formations. Now, and again, other important phenomena include weathering, erosion, and deposition. So, what happens is you have weathering, that is breaking down of a bigger rock particle into smaller fragments. So I have a rock mass that breaks up into a small mass. So we call that process as weathering or breaking up of rocks. Now if this same rock mass moves or is pushed away by any force, it can be water, wind, air. So that would lead into erosion. And finally, it would move somewhere and again start to deposit at a certain place. So that would be the process of deposition. Now, all three processes occur in glacial regions, occur in arid areas, occur in areas where there is water action, where there is underground water, that's the karst topography that we know about. So, all these are affected by the basic three phenomena that work on. Now, again, there are certain phenomena like plate tectonics. When we say plate tectonics, that means previously, it was believed that there is a single landmass known as Pangaea that lies within Penthalsa, that's the ocean body surrounding it. Slowly and gradually, this Pangaea started to divide with the northern part as Angara land and the southern region as Gondwana land, and the region between the two was known as the Tethys River, which with gradual depositions from both sides, this tried to evolve into young fold mountains, which are known as the present day Himalayas. And so we attribute the formation of Himalayas from the river Tethys that flowed between the two regions, the north and the south plates. Later on, there was another theory that focused on plate tectonics, or it explained that there are plates and these plates have certain movements. So there are three basic movements through which the plates exist, and they kind of move around on the surface, and those are either the two plates are coming close by, so we call it convergent boundaries. When they go far away, we call those as divergent boundaries, and when they slip past one another, we call those as transform boundaries. So there are the three basic plate boundaries that exist. Now again, important thing to note is most of the volcanic and the earthquake activities takes place along the plate margins. However, in certain cases, you have volcanic and earthquake activities which are seen within the plates. So now let's say I have drawn South America and North America here, and you have the Pacific area here. So the region of China and Russia. So this whole region is the Pacific Ring of Fire. And this whole region is one of the plate margins where you have most of the earthquake and the volcanic activities. However, if we talk about Hawaii as an island, Hawaii is located within the Pacific plate. Okay, so it acts as a hot spot and it's not a part of the plate margin where the volcanic activities are occurring. So the volcanic activity in the island of Hawaii would be an example of the volcanic activity which occurs within the plate, not on the plate margins. So these are some of the ways under which we understand the formation of a land area. Now in India, typically if we talk about, we can say you have the northern region, which are the Himalayan mountains or laden by mountains. Then you have the plain area and finally the plateau area. So that would be a kind of very broad definition or very broad division or classification for India. So I have north as Himalayas, then I have the plains, and then I have the plateau region. Now this plateau is a result of volcanic eruptions that took place years back, and as a result this region is rich in igneous and metamorphic rock. Then you have the plain areas, which are well drained by numerous rivers that flow into the region. As a result, these deposits are alluvial deposits. And finally, you have the northern Himalayan region, which originated from the river Tethys. These are young fold mountains. They are much more recent in origin, and they are also geologically unstable because we say they are still evolving. So you have the northern region, which is the Himalayan region, which is relatively unstable. Now, if we classify the regions in India, we can broadly say there are 6 physiographic divisions in India. So you have the northern Himalayan region, then you have the northern plains, you have the peninsular plateau, the desert region of India, the coastal regions of India, and finally the island groups. So we'll classify and we'll understand these regions one by one. So let's first start with the Himalayan region. Now the Himalayan region can be again subdivided into 3 regions. The topmost, Himadri, then you have Himachal, and the lowermost are Shivaliks. Now let's understand the first one, that's the Himadri. The Himadris are the northernmost mountains, the northernmost ranges of the mountain, and the best mnemonic to remember them is KLZS, that is Karakoram, Ladakh, Zaskar and Shyok. So you have the 4 basic Shivaliks, the 4 basic ranges that run, and that's the best way to remember the top layers. Now of these, Karakoram and Ladakh form the Trans-Himalayan region. So you have a length of nearly 2400 kilometers. These are more wider towards the west. You have nearly 400 kilometers wide. However, as they reach Arunachal Pradesh, their width decreases and they remain only 150 kilometers wide. The core of the Himalayan mountain is made up of granite. Now, next to the Himalayas, or the greater Himalayas, we also call those as Himadris, you have the Himachal, which are the middle Himalayas. The common ranges of middle Himalayas are Pir Panjal, Dholadhar and Mahabharat range. The major hill stations here are Kangra, Kullu. So all these are the hill stations which are found in the middle Himalayan range, that is the Himachal. However, between the middle Himalayas and the Shivaliks, there are small hilllocks, and those are known as dunes. So all the names that end with dune would be a kind of region which are located on a small hilllock or a small height. Examples would be Dehradun, Patli Dune, Kotli Dune. So all these are places, are kind of hill stations, I could say, where you have hills which are not as vast as Himachal range, but not as low as the Shivalik range. Now Shivalik range, you have an average height of 900 to 1000 meters, and you have an expanse of nearly 10 to 50 kilometers. Now these was the range division north to south. We have another division which moves from west to east. So in the westmost, this division, we work around the basic rivers that flow into the region. So the westmost area is Indus. Then you have Satluj River, Kali River, Tista River, that's the name for the Brahmaputra, and finally Dihang, which we call Brahmaputra in Assam. Now this all rivers, you have different sections that they make. So the region between Indus and Satluj is known as Punjab Himalayas. Between Satluj and Kali River, we call them as Kumaon Himalayas. Between Kali and Tista, it's mainly the Nepal region and the northern regions of Uttar Pradesh. We call those as Nepal Himalayas. And finally, Tista and Dihang, we call those as Assam Himalayas. So this is a classification moving from west to east. The first classification we did was from north to south. Now, beyond the Brahmaputra River, we also have kind of hills which move or kind of bend eastward as we move there. So you have, beyond the Himalayas, you have another mountain range that exists, which is known as Purvanchal. They are mainly composed of sedimentary rocks and sandstones. The common ranges which form the Purvanchal are the Patkai Pumps, Naga Hills, Manipur Hills and Mizo Hills. Now the next is the Northern Plains. These plains account for around 7 lakh square kilometer of the area, which is 2400 kilometer long and nearly 250 to 300 kilometer broad. It is drained mainly by the three rivers, that's the Indus Ganga and the Brahmaputra. Composed of the alluvial soils, it has many distributaries. Now the western part of it is known as Punjab Plains. Below the Punjab Himalayas, you have the Punjab Plains. It is composed of Indus and its tributaries, which form the Doab. So Doab means Do and Ab. So the plains that are fed by two rivers would be Doab. So similarly, you have the Ganga Plains, which are formed between the Ghaggar River and the Tista River, and Brahmaputra Plains, which form the most of Bihar, Jharkhand and West Bengal. Now, moving from north to south again, we classify Northern Himalayas into four sections. The northernmost is Bhabar. Bhabar runs parallel to the Shivaliks and it's the region where you do not see any streams and most of the streams disappear in this region. The next to Bhabar is the Tarai Belt, where the streams that have disappeared kind of re-emerges on the top and appears again. So this region is more or less wet and marshy. As a result, you have kind of huge forest that is found in this area. This lies south of Bhabar. A common example of a wildlife sanctuary here is the Dudhwa National Park. Next to Tarai, you have the Bangar, and next to Bangar you have the Khadar. So Bangar, being on an upper layer, is much older as compared to Khadar, which is the new deposits. So Bangar deposits are old. They have calcareous deposits within them, which are known as Kankar nodules. So you have Kankar nodules that exist in Bangar, and Bangar is the old alluvium. Next to Bangar you have the another, which is Khadar. These are much younger. And the region is known for the intensive agriculture and good crop production. Now next to the northern plains, you have the peninsular plateau. Now this time there was an important question that was asked, which explained what is the demarcating feature between the northern plains and the peninsular plateau, the Deccan plateau. So the demarcating feature here is the central highland. So within the region of peninsular plateau, you have the central highlands and the Deccan plateau. Central highland lies to the north of the Deccan plateau, and this region is typically north of Narmada river. So the region that forms the central highland is known as the Malwa plateau, and the extension of Malwa plateau is the Hadoti plateau that exists in the state of Rajasthan in the regions of Kota in Rajasthan, and this Malwa plateau is mainly in the region of Madhya Pradesh. Now, this whole peninsular region was formed by breaking up of the Gondwana land. It is assumed to be the part of among the oldest land features that exist in India. It is broad and shallow with a small rounded hills that exist. Most of the rocks here, as we discussed previously, since it was a volcanic origin, those are mainly igneous, and under high pressure and temperature, some of them have changed to metamorphic rocks. The soil is predominantly black soil, which is good for cotton cultivation. So you have lots and lots of cotton cultivation in the plateau region. Now this central highland, the northwestern side is bound by the Aravali Mountains. So you have towards the northwest, you have the Aravalis, and towards the south, you have the Vindhyas. And as we said, in the north, you have the Narmada River that flows. Now, this region has another characteristics. It is much wider on the west and it becomes narrower towards the east. So it's much wider towards the west, and as you move east, it becomes much narrower. So you have the next region, which is the Deccan Plateau. So north of Narmada, you have the central highlands, and south of Narmada you have the Deccan Plateau. Now this Deccan Plateau, again you have the northern edges which meet with the Satpura Ranges, and towards the eastern side You have another kind of mountain ranges, which are Mahadev, Kemur range, and Makul range. So these lie towards the eastern boundary. Now this plateau has another extension which could be seen in the northeast India. And this plateau, which is seen in the northeast India, is mainly the Meghalaya and the Karbi Along plateau. This is separated by a fault zone, and then we call it GKJ, which is another mnemonic that you can remember. That is Garo Hills, Khasi Hills, and Jayanta Hills. And these move as we move from west to east. So you have GKJ, that is Garo, Khasi, and Jayanta Hills, that exist in the northeastern region, which is again an extension of the peninsular region. Now, beyond the peninsular region, you have the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats. So, Western Ghats are more continuous in nature. They are much narrower. However, the Eastern Ghats are much broad and they are much discontinuous or irregular. The reason being, there are lots and lots of rivers that flow here and form delta. Like you have the Mahanadi, then you have the Krishna, Godavari. So, all these rivers form deltas towards the Eastern Ghats. So it is much discontinuous as compared to Western Ghats, which is more continuous. There are three famous ghats that exist in the Western Ghats. Those are the Thal Ghat, Bor Ghat, and the Pal Ghat. And the common mountain peaks in this region are Anaimudi and Dodabeta. However, towards the Eastern Ghats, you have the Mahendragiri Hill, which is one of the highest points in the Eastern Ghats. And another common hills here are the Chevroy and the Javadi Hills. So this is the basic structure of the peninsular region. Now moving on to the desert area, it lies to the west of the Aravali range, that's here. So west of the Aravali, that's covering most of the western parts of Rajasthan, you have the Indian desert, which is also known as Thar desert. It is known for the sand dunes. Since it's a desert area, there is less rainfall. Region with the less rainfall and kind of dry weather conditions are known as arid climates. So it's a kind of arid climate. The only river that flows into this region is the Luni River. Now most of the desert area, you would find crescent shaped dunes, which are the most common ones. And these crescent shaped dunes are known as Barkans. We have already covered those in the class on Aeolian landforms, when we have talked about the landforms that are formed by wind action, which are known as Aeolian landforms. And then you have the next, which is known as the longitudinal dunes. These dunes are common towards the boundary region of India and Pakistan. Now moving on to the coastal plains, you have the two coasts of India, the west coast and the east coast. So we'll talk about those one by one. Let's first go on to the western coastal plains. Western coastal plains are the region that lies between the Western Ghats, the three ghats that we talked about, the Thal Ghat, Bor Ghat, and the Pal Ghat. So you have the region between the Western Ghats and the Arabian Sea would be the West Coast Plains. They are much narrower and they are fragmented into three sections. The northernmost is the Konkan Zone that moves from Mumbai to Goa, the region between Mumbai to Goa. Then you have the Kannad Zone, and finally the lowermost towards the Kerala region, you have the Malabar Zone. Now coming on to the Western Ghats, they are much wider and much leveled as compared to the western coast. They are again divided into two parts. The northern part is known as the Northern Sirkars and the southern part is known as the Coromandel Coast. Now there are many rivers that form delta here, as we talked about, which move from the ghat areas of the eastern region. You have Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri as the main rivers that drain here. Again, the eastern coastal plain is known for its Chilka Lake, which is one of the largest saltwater lakes. It is formed on Mahanadi River in Odisha. Now moving on to the two island groups, one towards the west and one towards the east. The one towards the west is known as Lakshadweep. Kavrati is the capital for Lakshadweep. It's the administrative headquarters. Pitli is one of the islands in Lakshadweep, which is uninhabited but has a bird sanctuary there. The previous names of Lakshadweep was Lakadweep, Minicoy and Amnideep. It lies close to the Malabar coast of Kerala. It is also known for the coral reefs which are found there. One of the most famous coral reefs of the world are the Great Barrier Coral Reefs, which are seen on the coast of Queensland in Australia. Here you would find mainly the fringing and the barrier reefs. Atolls are those which are kind of circular coral formations where you have a water body within. Then you have the Andaman and the Nicobar Islands. Again, we can say the northern portion is the Andaman, the southern portion is the Nicobar Islands. These are much bigger and numerous as compared to the Lakshadweep, which are less inhabited. One of the active volcanoes that's unique to Andaman and Nicobar region is the Barren Island, and it's the only active volcano that exists in India. With this, we cover the physical features of India. We'll be covering the drainage in the next class. You can subscribe to our channel for further updates. Have a good day.